Hi, I'm your host, Tom DeSavia. Join me as I interview guests from music and entertainment from around the world about what they're up to right now. Stay tuned, because we're gone in 30 minutes.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the latest episode of Gone in 30 Minutes, and I'm so excited to have as my guest today, Rhett Miller, one of my favorite songwriters in the world, one of my dearest pals, and my longest professional relationship. How do you like that?
There's got to be. Wasn't Linda Ronstadt before me?
Yeah, no, but and there's plenty before you, but you were the longest professional relationship. And just in tribute, at one point in the 90s, when we all wore big shirts like Chandler on Friends, you bought me like an XXXL Dallas Stars shirt when you were trying to get me into sports one of those times. And this is, I think, the first time I've worn it. So I'm very happy to wear this today.
Just, you want it back? I'm guaranteeing right now that Elektra Records bought that. There's no way I bought that.
This was a gift. If you got Elektra Records to buy me a shirt, well, you got them to buy you everything else. So this makes sense. Let's get on with the show. Rhett, what are you doing right now?
Well, I'm here in my office, which is my workplace nowadays. I used to drive around from town to town, but now I do four shows a week in this chair, in this room, usually with this dog behind me, Ziggy sleeping there. And it's really weird, but there's a lot of good things about it, and I'm trying to focus on those. But boy, do I miss human beings that aren't my two teenage children. I love them, don't get me wrong, but I don't miss them at all.
But you miss them when you were on the road. I know that for a fact.
I used to miss them all the time. So that's a giant. That to me is the biggest silver lining of all of this.
And the best song title I've heard come out of your mouth in like 10 years. I used to miss them all the time. Come on. Anyway.
I'm going to write that down.
Well, and just for our audience, you're in upstate New York. So you're 3 hours ahead of me.
Yeah, well, it's not. When I first moved here 17 years ago, I would tell people it was upstate New York. But I got in trouble from people in Albany, Rochester, Syracuse. I'm in the Hudson Valley, so it's like 90 minutes north of Manhattan. It's not like a bedroom community of New York City, but or a suburb of New York City, but it's kind of suburb adjacent. So I'm not really upstate. I'm not to split hairs with you, Tom. Actually,
we only got 30 minutes, Rhett. Rhett, how many? This is from upstate New York, our guest. It's New York and it's upstate. We're just going to stick with that. No, but I want to say, and there's so many things I want to cover, and we only have a half hour, and a lot about just making a record in the looming coronavirus time that we're in. But specifically, immediately when we finish this record, I just want to jump to this, because tonight, or by the time our viewers have seen this, I should say, you will have taped your 100th episode of your podcast that you started on March.
Live stream concert, not podcast.
You have a separate podcast. The live stream concerts that you started on what date?
March 18th was my very first ever live stream concert. Say hello to my 16-year-old son, Max Miller.
Hi. What's happening, Max? Hi. What's up, Tom?
How you doing, buddy?
What's up? What's up, Tom?
Good at my work.
Peace out.
But when you did it,
you okay?
But you entered it. We'd finished working on the last old 97's record in Nashville. We all flew home on March 11th, I believe, and immediately went into lockdown.
Yeah.
And you immediately went online to do these concerts.
Yeah, the timeline for me was fly home March 12th, New York State shuts down March 13th. I spend 2.5 days researching platforms, which, you know, I mean, I now know how to do a lot of things on the computer. At the time, I knew how to do very few things on the computer. So it needed to be easy. And March 16th, I booked my first show. March 18th, I did my first show online. And we're taping this now almost exactly 6 months later. And I have done 100. Tonight will be 103 shows. And then I'm going to take a week off and start season two shortly thereafter.
What? So the motivation, just because this is, I think, just talking to writers about what they're going through right now. The motivation was a combination of wanting to play music because you knew you weren't going to tour for a while, and some panic of this is what I do for a living. And so what were you like headed into that? And what is it like now when you do these shows? Because you've got, as I've sort of said, you have your own Largo audience that's international that tunes in four times a week. But where was your head at when you started? And
well, I remember thinking a lot when I was in high school and caught up in like all the intellectual questions and the existential questions. I remember thinking a lot about the idea of form without function and form versus function. And my function is to make music. I do shows, I write songs, and you know, I can parse that into different functions. Writing songs is one thing, and it's kind of tends to be a really solitary thing. Sometimes you co-write, but typically it's a solitary thing. Performing is kind of a social thing. Even though I'm facing one direction, everybody else is facing the other direction, it still happens in a group. But that's my primary function. And so if all I'm able to do is the solitary part of that, which right, you know, when you're about to put out a record, and we were just finishing the old 97s record, you have 4 months until the record comes out. Like normally that's a time when I am not writing songs at all. Like I'm good. Nobody needs songs from me for a while. So that's normally a time when I am making hay while the sun shines. I'm doing gigs, solo gigs till the record comes out. Record comes out, I'm doing band gigs. That is my function. So that function was taken away from me and all my brethren in rock. Like we're, you know, the thing we do, they put out the state of Texas. You wouldn't think they would be doing things like this, but they put out a list of the most dangerous things you can do to spread the virus. And you know, like the least dangerous thing you could do is sit in your office and pet your dog. The most dangerous thing you can do is be in a group of people singing. Like the most dangerous thing you can do is the thing that I do. So I suddenly became form without function. And so I started trying to think of, okay, how can I do the thing that I do? And I mean, a big part of that was how can I replace the lost income? Because as I mentioned, I've got these two teenagers and all they do is eat. And now one of them has to buy gas every 2 days because he's driving all day, every day. So it's intense, you know, like when we first met and I was 25 years old, nobody depended on me. Like they would have been foolish to depend on me. Now, multiple people and a dog depend on me. So I had to come up with not only a way to make money and feed them, but also a way to keep sane. And these shows, as weird as they are and as not a straight amalgam for rock and roll concerts, as you know, there it's not the equivalent, but it is a replacement and it's kept me sane. Ish. Sane-ish.
Going to back what you're saying, so how is, because it's funny, we were talking about this the other day. Every once in a while, someone will ask me about your process or about a specific song. And I'll look at them, I'm like, you know, I don't really know. We as long as we were, the 25 years we've literally worked together, unless I was physically there when you were starting to write the song or you'd written it in my presence, I never really knew what the song was about. If I thought I knew what it was about, I'd usually say, oh, that was obviously about this breakup. And then you'd be like, oh, no, that song was actually 8 years old. So I just given up trying to figure out, and I don't really want to know, but I don't really know, aside, even from this album that we just did an album together in A&R band capacity for the first time in many, many, many years. And these songs kept showing up in a wonderful way, but I don't know where they came from. I don't know which ones had been sitting there. I don't know which ones were new. I don't know which ones were partial songs that existed 6 years ago. So now that you're in your home for 6 months, you're playing a different role of rock star online. Are you still writing?
Well, that's That, okay, so you know how I was saying that there's two facets to what I do, and one is the performative and the other is the strictly creative. The creative part has been really, really hard for me during the pandemic. I keep coming back to and referencing this New Yorker cartoon that depicts a guy in a rowboat with like shark fins and a ship sinking behind him. Or, well, not a rowboat, but a, what do they call it? Like a rescue boat, safety boat with life, a life raft. He's in a life raft. Shark fins, boat sinking behind him, lightning striking, just all hell breaking loose in the middle of the ocean. And he's saying, oh, this is the perfect time to finish my novel. Like, that's how I feel. Like, how am I supposed to be creative in the midst of a global pandemic and a personal massive crisis of identity, you know? So I had not written a song until last week. I took the family to Delaware because they came off the quarantine list, thank God. And we went to the beach. And I woke up early, as I've been doing every morning. I've been doing morning pages. I started doing The Artist's Way, which is this book. Brian Koppelman, the writer, recommended it to me. But it's this really great book about sort of getting unblocked as an artist. And a big part of the technique is you wake up and you write three pages, stream of consciousness, your morning pages. It can be about anything. And it's been super helpful to me just in terms of getting things out, because that's what art, for me, has always been, making art. So those days I woke up, wrote my morning pages, and I wrote two songs while I was there. One of them, maybe pretty good. The other one I think is so beautiful, and it's one of my favorite songs I've written in a long time. So I'm finally feeling like I'm getting unblocked, but man, it has taken a solid 6 months to just, because I feel like I can't even catch my breath. I'm so scared about the loss of my job. I'm so scared I won't be able to feed my kids. I'm so scared that the thing that I've done that I always felt like no one could take it away from me has been kind of taken away from me, and I've had to figure out a whole new system. And I think it's going well, but I still don't trust it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it, and that's such a common shared feeling, not just by creators of art, but I think everybody in their way of, like, I was just talking to someone earlier, I'm a pretty avid reader. And I just, that's what I do to unwind. I've not been able to read since this has started, just because my brain is working so fast that I just keep reading the same chapter over and over. But but I think it's really helpful for people that are guests on here to talk to each other almost about being blocked and the, like I said, like your footing being off, because you had a cycle that we never thought would end, meaning tour album break, I should say. But when you found you, now that you're writing again, which I didn't even know you'd been blocked this whole time, did it come to you in sort of this, the way it always does? Did it feel different? Was the writing process, was it just like, oh, right, I remember how to ride a bike and I'm doing it? Or was there a different muse looming about?
Well, I've always believed in, you have to put yourself in a position to create, like to be creative. So the idea that you wait for the muse to come find you, I think that's baloney. I think that's a story people tell themselves as a way of procrastinating, or as a way of denying their inner artist the right to go out and make the thing they need to make. So those mornings in Delaware, for instance, I sat down to write songs, and I had done that during the previous 6 months. Jenna Fisher, the actress who was on The Office and played Pam, and she has a podcast now about The Office, and she had asked me to write a song, and I did, and it was like a joke song. So I had sat down to write that song, and it was fine, but it didn't feel like a real song. Like, for me, a real song has to be something that surprises me, kind of comes out of nowhere. I'm its first audience. So that's what happened with these. I just sat down and I said, I would really love to write a song. And I kind of feel like I could. I'm in a good place. Like, physically, I was looking out a window at, you know, with some pretty trees and flowers. And it's funny, because that was one of my pet peeves, is when people start a song with, I woke up this morning and dot, 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 because it's just so lazy. Or I looked out my window and dot, dot, dot. Like, these are just, these are hack. These are hackneyed. Of course, the exception sometimes proves the rule, because the song that I love so much, this brand new, starts with the line, windows out my window, because it was that, like, I was looking out a window at all these other windows. These houses were kind of all around me in this sort of beach community. And it's just that thing of, you know, what stories hide behind these windows? And it was, to me, that is the ultimate impetus for songs. I can't even tell you how many songs I've written from Broadway that I wrote while you were waiting in the lobby of the Paramount Hotel in New York City, looking out the window of that hotel room. I've written so many songs looking out of windows at other windows, imagining the story behind them. It's like people watching if the people are hiding, you know? And so I get to make up what they're doing. And so it was kind of the way it's always been. But it took me finally getting to a place where I could just catch my freaking breath for 5 minutes.
And did you feel like you were back on the bike? Did it it's kind of, because I think it's just, I've talked to so many people that are blocked and in their own way, and the people that are disciplined and blocked, or the people that are undisciplined and blocked, because they're, ultimately, there is no proper way to do anything. It's just however it strikes you, right? And everybody's thing has fallen off. I just want to go back real quick, just a little backstory for our listeners. So this would have been back in the year of our Lord, 1996. And Rhett and I were still dating, and I'd flown him and his band, the old 97s, to New York as we were trying to wine and dine them and get them to sign to Elektra Records. And we had stayed at the Paramount Hotel. Was it the Paramount?
It was the Paramount. That was the hipster hotel in New York at the time.
Yeah, it was the hotel where all the bands stayed. And we got there, and we all got in at the airport. We went to the hotel, and it was like, all right, everyone check in your rooms, and let's meet down here in 50 minutes, and we're going to go to a meeting or dinner or whatever we were going to go do. And Rhett called me in the room and said, as before, like 5 minutes before we go down, he's like, oh, I just wrote a song, like just when I got in here. And I remember thinking, like, the guy's either showboating, and now I'm going to go by and hear this song. And is it like, and I just didn't know you that well. And you played me Broadway exactly as it wound up on the record. And that was the moment where, that was the moment I fell in love with Rhett.
Yes.
That was it. That was an amazing moment. The other, I had to say, for inspiration was, there was a brief period when you were staying with me in Los Angeles during the writing of Fight Songs. Mm-hmm. And I walked into my house one day, and that was when refrigerator magnets were really big. And the first verse of Alone So Far was on my fridge, which made no sense to me. So that's why I never want to know where songs come from, because the answer might be refrigerator magnets. I want to jump ahead to, we made this record, Twelfth, which just came out and had an amazing first week. So congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Doing well. But it was a completely different, like, process the entire way through. And if you could maybe talk about that a little bit, and our good pal Vance Powell, and just how this record was mixed and in the time of lockdown.
Boy, so, first of all, I was so glad that you agreed to, or insinuated yourself into the position of A&R.
Yeah.
which is great. And for those, I mean, I'm assuming at this point that maybe anybody watching this or listening to this knows that A&R stands for artist and repertoire. But really what it is, it's kind of just babysitting. Like, you're sort of, you know, you're going back and forth between band members and saying, well, you know, so-and-so really likes this song, but he doesn't get this. And maybe you could do this to make him understand. You know, it's like just, oh, my God, the diplomacy that you have to do between band members over something so stupid as, like, which of the 12 out of these 14 finalists are going to make the cut and all that. But it's necessary because making a record, being in a band, is all about compromise. It's all about collaboration. It's all about respecting each other to the point where you can agree even though you disagree. And in the end, you can feel good about what you've wound up with, your final list of songs, the final mix on a song. So you helped so much with that. Vance Powell, our producer on this record, had produced our most recent record before this, Graveyard Whistling. And to do a second album with a producer is a pretty lucky thing, because so much, like, my bandmates and I have been in a band together for 27 years, right? So we've learned all there is to know about each other. You know, you have worked with me and those guys in an A&R capacity and been our friend for 20, 5 years. So, you know, we know, we all know the shorthand. We all know when to back off, when to push, all the different things. So when Vance came in as our producer for the first record, we clicked really quickly, but there's still a learning curve. So for the second record, like suddenly all of that is done. You get to go in and bam, as soon as we showed up in Sputnik Studios in the Berry Hill neighborhood of Nashville, and we loaded in, and it's a little studio. It's Vance's home studio, which he mostly, not home, it's Vance's studio in Nashville, in his hometown. But it's not a big room. It has a drum room. It has some small rooms on the side. It's not like CBS A studio or whatever, where you're in this some giant room. But it was quick. He knows how to get the sounds he wants. We know how to work with each other. We had done enough pre-production to be off book on most of the songs. I mean, for me for sure, just because I work on the songs over and over. So we were able to sit down, and right off the bat from day one, we were getting keeper takes, which meant all the drums, all the bass, a lot of the guitar, all my rhythm guitar, a lot of my vocals. And we made this record so quickly. And to think back on the era when even the 97s made records for $250,000. And then I had solo record. I had a solo record that was $300,000 and another one that was $400,000. Think about that. $750,000 to make two dumb Rhett Miller solo records. That's insane. So when people wonder, why did the old business model collapse? Well, it was the Rhett Miller solo record budgets. We can all agree on that.
It's true.
So you don't need that much money to make a record. In fact, I think that sometimes that much money and that much time and that much pressure can work against you. So for us to go in, work quickly, capture the live takes, not get too hung up on everything being perfect, I think that really worked in our favor. I'm not sure what it was with me. You sort of asked earlier about the songs, how many of them were old versus new. I had a bunch of really great songs that were left over. But after the last old 97s album, Graveyard Whistling, and after The Messenger, I still had a stack of like 20 songs. But then I went in and wrote the 12 songs that are on this record were probably the newest songs. And for some reason, I was in a place where I was thinking a lot about the gratitude I feel for our band and the years we've spent together. And if there is a concept album hiding in 12th, it is that. It is that here we are 27 years into our career, feeling closer to each other than we ever have, feeling more successful, and not in terms of chart or sales, but in terms of like, oh my God, we make better music now than we did 27 years ago, or at any point during that timeline, maybe. It's just such a good feeling, and it's so unlikely. So if there's a concept album hiding in these songs, it's that, oh my God, we've done this. We're doing this better than we ever have 27 years in.
And I so agree. And just to go to what you're saying, just for our listeners that aren't totally familiar with everything about the band, this band is the same four members for the last 27 years, never a change. And I was lucky to get to build independent and individual friendships with all of you. I like every guy in this band. I would never make another band record ever again as long as I live, and I won't. But this was so different because it was like going home. But I wanted to give extra props as going in there. It was very much a blind date with Vance Powell, who was the producer. And my role, like I said, is different than a Svengali type A&R person who's going to come in and help arrange the songs and just there to buy you lunch. But when I got in there and I waited and I watched Vance, to me, Vance Powell, and look up his stuff. He's an amazing engineer, producer, and mixer. Is exactly what every band dreams of. He was engaged. He was involved. I loved sitting there watching him. He wasn't just collecting a paycheck. He became the fifth member of the band for those sessions, and it was fantastic. And when we went straight into quarantine, one of the things that really got me through those first couple of months of being hit by a truck was this concept that we were able to mix a record all being in our own homes in different parts of the U.S. while Vance sat there in Nashville, and it was amazing to watch it come together. So,
yeah,
love all of you. All right, we are going to enter what's called the lightning round, Rhett, because we don't want to end this on a heavy note of me saying, oh, yeah, your band's great, you're a good songwriter. I have Sammy Davis Jr.'s hat, as you may remember, you may not. but I got it. And then here are some questions, and we're just going to go. Quick word association, all right? I'm just going to reach in.
I'll do my Sammy Davis Jr. impression as I... Sorry, I don't actually have one.
I was going to say, would I? No, it's glass eyes. So wait. Okay, we'll do this. First celebrity crush. Go.
Joan Jett.
Whoa, good one. Okay, I knew that. What's the most useless talent you have?
I can hang 11 spoons off my face.
I don't know how I continue after that.
I can't.
We're going to have you back with 11 spoons. If you could travel back in time, what period would you go to?
Oh, my gosh. I know. Okay. Not really, but the Wild West, because I love Elmore Leonard's Western novels.
Oh, how literally
horrible to live.
If you could visit one place on Earth, where would you go right now?
Greece, because that's where Soleil wants to go, my daughter. And I would take her and everybody in my family and you, Tom, to Greece, an island.
You're just saying that because you're on a podcast with me. Let's see. Here's one that I've never seen before. If you were a pair of shoes, what kind of shoes would you be?
Lagavulin. I don't even know what that means. Is that a whiskey? Damn it.
It's a whiskey.
Some fancy.
What kind of shoes would you be? You'd be whiskey. Who is a celebrity you admire and why? And the why is the important part.
You know what? I'm going to say John Doe. He just popped into my head, but he's somebody that was a hero to me when I was 15 years old. But he wound up being sort of a mentor over the years. I just like the way he's aged gracefully. He's never sort of stopped being himself. He doesn't apologize for himself. He's just a cool dude.
Yeah, agreed. And I totally agree on that one. Can you pick up something with your toes?
Oh, yeah. I can pick up all sorts of things with my toes.
Okay. Gonna remember that next time I come to
chicks. I can pick up chicks with my toes. Hey, baby.
What personality trait has gotten you in the most trouble?
Oh, Jesus. My alcoholism.
What movie scared you as a kid?
Poltergeist. I mean, didn't it scare all of us?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The meat in the face. Do you believe in fate, Rhett?
You know, I do. I do.
Do you own a bicycle, Rhett?
I own six. I mean, I only ride one of them, but I bought all of them.
What did you do with all that extra money from those budgets from those solo records, Rhett? That bikes. here's one. And it says, if your life was a movie, what songs would be on the soundtrack? But why don't we say what two songs would be on the soundtrack of your movie, of your life?
Weakest Shade of Blue by the Pernice Brothers, because it is so cinematic. And then also Bad Reputation. That's the closing credit song. I just thinking of Joan Jett, maybe because of how much I had a crush on her. But, you know, like there's some like quiet ending where you're just like, oh my God, I can't believe that was so moving. I don't give a damn about my bad reputation. And then like everybody gets up and they're like, I love that movie.
I forget now. Have you ever met Joan Jett? And did you tell her you had a crush on her?
Well, yes and no. Of course I'm not going to. I just met her this a year ago. We played a festival together and I got to meet her. But I'm not like, oh my God, I had such a crush on you, Joan Jett. Gross, Tom.
Thank you for the music. What would be the coolest animal to scale up to the size of a horse?
Ziggy, my poodle.
Poodle. Okay. That's sort of like the question I asked you. Hold on. What is the most embarrassing thing you've ever worn?
Oh my God. The pictures recently emerged of me wearing ripped up jorts, no shirt, on stage. What those pictures didn't show was that was the first gig of two gigs on July 4th, 1999. The second of those two gigs, I was so wasted. I was wearing an American flag as a cape, no shirt, ripped up jorts, shoeless. And I wound up passing out on stage. And when I came to, there was a girl making out with me. It was like a peak. I peaked.
Which will be the final scene in the movie that will end with Joan Jett. And with that, We are gone in 30 minutes, Rhett.
I said 1999. It's 1989. I will get in trouble with my wife. It's 1989 that happened. Oh, my God. Sorry. Yes.
That may be cut off the broadcast. We'll see if we can leave it on. Rhett, I love you. Thanks for sitting with us for a half hour. Really appreciate it. You're the best. One of my favorite people on the planet. Thank you, buddy.
Love you, Tommy D. Go shave. Go cut your hair.
Nope. Bye. Bye.
This show is presented by Craft Recordings. Thanks for joining us for Gone in 30 Minutes, produced by Laura Saez. I'm your host, Tom, and we'll catch you next time.